Hello students, welcome to EPG Parshala. This is Mrs. Prema Janardhan, Vice Principal, presenting on the Module 17, Conventional Programs of Crime Prevention. Learning objectives: to understand knowledge-based crime prevention, the public health model of crime prevention, primary crime prevention programs, secondary crime prevention programs, tertiary crime prevention programs. Introduction. The foundation of a proactive and effective crime prevention is laid through knowledge-based crime prevention. One of the principles provided under the UN guidance for crime prevention is that crime prevention strategies, policies, programs and actions should be based on a broad multidisciplinary foundation of knowledge about crime problems, their multiple causes and promising and proven practices. The guidelines that state governments and civil society should facilitate knowledge-based crime prevention by providing the information necessary for communities to address crime problems, supporting the generation of useful and practicable, applicable knowledge that is scientifically reliable and valid, supporting the organization and synthesis of knowledge and identifying and addressing gaps in the knowledge base, sharing that knowledge among researchers, policymakers, educators, practitioners from other relevant sectors and the wider community. Apply this knowledge in replicating successful interventions, developing new initiatives and anticipating new crime problems and prevention opportunities, establishing data system to help manage crime prevention more cost effectively, including by conducting regular surveys of victimization and offending, promoting the application of those data in order to reduce repeat victimization, persistent offending and areas with a high level of crime. Management of conventional crime prevention programs. Any conventional crime prevention program requires a systematic process of development and management, whether planning at national or local level. Planners should promote a process that includes a systematic analysis of crime problems, their causes, risk factors, consequences in a particular at the local level. A plan that draws on the most appropriate approach and adapt interventions to the specific local problem and context. An implementation plan to deliver appropriate interventions that are efficient, effective and sustainable. Mobilizing entities that are able to tackle causes. Monitoring and evaluation. Government, other funding bodies and those involved in program development and delivery should undertake short and long term evaluation to test rigorously what works, where and why. Undertake cost benefit analysis, assess the extent to which action results in reduction or in levels of crime and victimization in the series of crime and in fear of crimes. Systematically assesses the outcomes and unintended consequences, both positive and negative of action, such as decrease in crime rates or the stigmatization of individuals and our communities. Many guides to promote planning in crime prevention have been developed over the years. Police forces are the method of SARA, an acronym for scanning, analysis, response and assessment, which is forward-looking problem-solving approach. The European Network on Crime Prevention uses the 5 I's. The 5 I's is a series of headings to capture the essential elements of crime prevention or reduction initiative to so that lessons learned can be clear and decisions made about replication, comprises intelligence, intervention, implementation, involvement and impact. The European Beccaria standards for ensuring quality management in crime prevention projects provide a more detailed summary of the various steps involved in each of these main stages in project planning and management. The Beccaria standards set out the measures and steps that should be taken in the planning, execution and assessment of crime prevention programs and projects. They contain a set of detailed requirements for each of 7 key steps. Description of the problem, analysis of the conditions leading to the emergence of the problem, determination of previous targets, projects, target and targeted groups, termination of the interventions intended to achieve the targets, design and execution of the project, review of the projects, implementation and achievement of objectives. Conclusion and documentation. National plans need to be based on consultation across sectors and with civil society stakeholders, as well as research findings and data collection and analysis. This process will help to indicate various types of crime levels of insecurity and public concern and associated social and economic problems identified across the country. A national plan needs to indicate the main safety and crime and victimization challenges facing the country, its cities and rural areas. Their likely causes, priorities for intervention in the short, medium and long term. A set of proposed initiatives to address those priorities. The actors to be involved in implementing the plan. The funding and resources to be made available or matched. Setting priorities will depend in part on the extent and seriousness of problems, where they occur, the extent to which they appear to be increasing, levels of injury and fear associated with them, and the social and economic cost associated with them. They will include priority and place and neighborhoods or urban areas whereas offenses are occurring, and priority groups that are offending or victimized or both. The UNODC crime prevention assessment tool outlines some of the questions that need to be considered in terms of specific crime and victimization issues and the specific groups that may be affected. 66 developing a picture of the most vulnerable places and populations help to establish priority areas, priority offenses and priority groups that can benefit from the prevention strategy. Chile, for example, developed an index of criminal vulnerability to help target programs to those municipalities at the highest risk of crime and victimization. Brazil similarly selected high priority metropolitan areas as the target areas for its local funding initiative, part of its National Public Safety Program, PRONAISCI. Any plan needs to set very clear objectives showing that what is to be achieved, how the objectives are to be achieved and what time period. In some cases, countries have initiated targets on reduction in crime problems. In others, indicators have been established to assess progress in meeting the objectives. It is important to balance target setting with realistic interventions. However, to avoid raising expectations and provoking the loss of confidence in preventive approaches. In most cases, plans are established to set period of time such as 3, 5 or even 10 years. This allows for implementation and for assessment of the other impacts and outcomes before subsequent review and adaptation of strategies. Governments often choose to use a competitive process for the allocation of funds, inviting applications from local authorities and civil society organizations. These are always to encourage local governments and community organizations to develop prevention programs that meet local needs. For example, in Canada and Chile, Mexico, a competitive process for allocating funds to targeted priorities was employed under certain programs. In Canada, the province of Alberta has a community crime prevention grant program administered by Alberta Solicitor General and Public Security. It is available to support community crime prevention projects targeting priority groups and issues, at-risk individuals and their families, Aboriginal people and communities, measures enhancing the reporting of crime or interventions that are linked to a local safe community strategy. This may require linking to special education programs, outreach schools and mental health clinicians, addiction centers, child welfare agencies, police agencies, the alternative measure program, the extrajudicial sanctions program, or strategies addressing high crime neighbors. Targeted evidence-based approaches are given priority, more universal prevention initiatives. A total of $600,000 was available for the 2009 phase when applications for projects costing up to $50,000 were invited. The Comuna Segura program in Chile was initiated in 2001 as of the principal national government strategies to strengthen community safety. It formed part of the government's decentralization approach, giving greater autonomy to mayors and local authorities and empowering them to develop their own public safety policies. The National Community Safety Division selected municipalities based on an index of criminal vulnerability. Priority was given to the most vulnerable municipalities, and some received a percentage of funds directly from the government for high impact projects, but the competitive bidding process was the primary method of allocating funds. These were for specific targeted projects for vulnerable groups on subjects such as violence against women and children, school violence, and young people at risk. Funds were allocated for community safety projects involving local organizations as well as the municipalities. In the first 4 years of the project, a total of $23.3 million was allocated to the program, and 2,727 projects were funded. 67, the Federal Secretariat of Social Development in Mexico established its Recover Public Spaces program in 2000. The program provides funding to local authorities and communities to increase the safety and use of public spaces through the principles of environmental design. Cities and metropolitan areas with populations of over 50,000 are eligible to apply for funds, working in partnership with local communities and organizations. Implementation and evaluation need to be incorporated into action plans at the planning stage, not added as an afterthought. The training and support that governments can provide to projects and practitioners should also address these processes. Evaluation is a necessary tool for improving accountability, informing crime prevention policy and practice, for developing a sound evidence base and understanding of what works best and can be considered good practicing in addressing crime problems. Evaluation reflects on the design and implementation of a program to determine whether the chosen strategy has achieved its stated objectives. Evaluation is generally concerned with measuring the outcomes or impacts of a project or program. For example, the number of street children successfully reintegrated into stable family and community life could be established, or a decrease in assaults and thefts in areas provided with street lighting could be determined. Monitoring generally refers to the ongoing process of keeping track of trends and crime and victimization or other relevant information, or to information about project or program activities and the outputs they produce. For example, the number of street children given shelter and training could be established, or the number of streets that now has lighting to increase safety. An evaluation of a national or local crime prevention program or policy usually looks at three main components: how well policies and programs have been implemented and have achieved the objectives set, the immediate outcomes of projects, both expected and unexpected, the long-term outcomes and impact of those programs, for example, in terms of reduction of violence or improved employment and life skills, and any negative outcomes such as displacement of street crime or another area. This can include evaluating the cost and benefits of the program or policy. Public health model of crime prevention. A proactive approach of crime prevention that emerged in the 80s is the public health model of crime prevention. Brantingham and Faust put forth the idea of adopting the medical model of prevention and borrow the primary, secondary, tertiary analogy for the conceptualization of crime prevention efforts. The public health model focuses on reducing the risk of and increasing resilience against illness and disease. With its emphasis on prevention of disease or injury, the public health approach to violence offers an appealing alternative to an exclusive focus on rehabilitation or punishment. In criminal justice, this model has been adopted to understand the nature of violence and identify potential points of intervention. In the context of delinquency prevention, the public health model focuses on reducing the risk of and increasing resilience against problem behavior. It offers a practical, scientifically based procedure to promote and maintain pro-social behavior. Violence results from a confluence of multiple factors, including personal behaviors amenable to change, as well as family, neighborhood, and social system that are themselves modifiable. Just as application of public health principles and comprehensive strategies reduced the number of deadly traffic accidents and the number of deaths attributable to tobacco use, the public health model can help to reduce the extent of injuries and deaths due to violence. In essence, the public health approach follows a four-step procedure to identify problems and develop solutions for entire population groups. These steps are: define the nature of the problem using scientific methods, identify potential causes through analysis of risk and protective factors associated with problems, design, develop, and evaluate interventions, disseminate useful models as part of education and outreach. Types of conventional crime prevention programs. The public health model distinguishes three levels of prevention: primary prevention, secondary prevention, and tertiary prevention. Primary crime prevention programs. Primary prevention encompasses activities designed to prevent crimes before they might otherwise occur, sometimes also referred to as universal prevention. Such activities typically target whole populations, regardless of whether some members of a given population may be at greater or lesser risk. Whole populations can be defined in many ways. Example, citizens of a district, all school children, all residents of a neighborhood, and so on. Universal prevention can also be place-based prevention. Thus, prevention activities may be focused on specific types of settings: all schools, all parks, all public toilets, and so on. As a comprehensive strategy, activities can be devised to aim to prevent crimes in the first place by targeting potential offenders, potential victims, and settings where such crimes may otherwise occur. Repito has identified this type of prevention as mechanical crime prevention. However, he warns that mechanical prevention programs can have a displacement effect. Opportunity reduction can merely shift the incidence of crime to other forms, times, and localities. Primary prevention can be done in any context or location, whether a residence, workplace, school, neighborhood, community, or society. Primary prevention involves altering the environment in such a way that the root causes, or at least the facilitators of crime, are eliminated. As such, primary prevention is typically driven by supportable theory about the etiology of crime. An early example of this would be the social disorganization theory of Shaw and McCabe, which stated that the residential mobility and racial heterogeneity led people to have little interest in improving their neighborhood and more of an interest in moving out, leaving behind an area where crime could be easily occur. More recent examples include Newman's defensible space theory, Cohen and Felsen's routine activities theory, and Wilson's and Kelling's broken windows theory. The theory of defensible space, like its counterpart, is the field of private security called crime prevention through environmental design. tends to have a focus on preventing easy access to and exit by potential criminals, as well as the eliminator of their hiding place and where they can go geographically select a target. Routine activist theory posits a high rate of potential victims becoming actual victims whenever three things occur in space and time together: the absence of capable guardians, an abundance of motivated offenders, and suitable targets. Broken windows theory argues that signs of decay, disorder, and incivilities such as abandoned buildings, broken streets, lights, graffiti all invite potential criminals to an area. On a larger level, primary prevention can be based on macro social theories about the causes of crime in society, with examples of such effort being job, housing, education, healthcare, and religious programs. Secondary crime prevention programs. Secondary crime prevention engages in early identification of potential offenders and seeks to intervene in their lives in such a way that they never commit criminal violation. Secondary prevention refers to techniques focused on at-risk situations such as youth who are dropping out of school and getting involved in gangs. It also refers to targeting social programs and law enforcement into neighborhoods where crime rates are high. The uses of secondary crime prevention in cities such as Birmingham and Bogota have achieved large reduction in crime and violence. Programs that are focused on youth at risk, such as youth inclusion programs in England and or quantum opportunities in the USA, have been shown to significantly reduce crime. Secondary prevention involves a focus upon specific problems, places, and times, with twin goals of reducing situation-specific opportunities for crime and increasing risks for committing crime. Following Clark, many people call this situational crime prevention. Secondary prevention is most typically based on well-established law enforcement practices, such as problem-oriented policing, where the problem drives a team solution, hotspot analysis, which targets certain areas for saturation or directed patrol, surveillance and target hardening, which increases the risk and effort for committing crime, property identification, security, lighting, intrusion alarms, neighborhood watch, citizen patrols, protection personnel, and efforts on the part of victims to change their lifestyle. A major criticism of secondary prevention is that it doesn't really reduce crime but displaces it to other areas. Criminological theories that have been developed in this area include routine activities theory, lifestyle theory. Lifestyle theories pose that individuals who lead deviant lifestyles, such as abuse of drugs or alcohol, spending time on the street, or association with deviant peers, are themselves more likely to be high risk of victimization. Rational choice theory emphasizes the calculated decision making that offenders engage in while determining the payoff and risks for certain crimes. Additional reward risk models can be found in the criminological literature for specific offense categories. Tertiary crime prevention programs. Tertiary crime prevention deals with the actual offenders and involves intervention in their lives in such a fashion that they will not commit future offenses. Conceptual model of crime prevention, 1976. Tertiary prevention is used after a crime has occurred in order to prevent successive incidents. Such measures can be seen in the implementation of new security policies following acts of terrorism, most notably the September 11, 2001 attacks. Tertiary prevention is a term taken from the field of medicine to describe procedures to be taken after a disease or threat is manifested. Such procedures typically serve as a deterrence or minimization of harm. Purpose and are almost always characterized by being reactive or after the fact. Examples would include personal injury or property insurance, as well as self-protective measures engaged in by those who have been victimized previously. Carrying a non-concealed self-protective device or walking in a self-confident manner accomplishes the purpose of deterrence. Carrying a concealed device or whistle to blow for help accomplishes the purpose of minimization of, or at least the chance for, an unsuccessful criminal outcome. In some cases, a victim's device may be turned against him or her and result in greater harm, but these cases are probably few in number, since it is known that less than 5% of homicides involve the killers using the victim's gun. Tertiary prevention is often symbolic, as the with getting tough legislation and other legal reforms, which makes the punishment for crime more certain, severe and swift. Conclusion: proactive and effective crime prevention is possible only if it is based on using appropriate knowledge and information to promote good understanding about the current crime situations, the underlying causes of crime and potential preventive strategies. The conventional crime prevention programs follow the PST, primary, secondary, tertiary model, that is an analogy of the public health model. The public health model distinguishes three levels of prevention: primary prevention, secondary prevention and tertiary prevention. The model focuses on reducing the risk of and increasing resiliency against problem behavior. It offers a practical, scientifically based procedure to promote and maintain pro-social behavior. Primary prevention encompasses activities targeted at whole population through reducing opportunities for crime. They are done in any context or location, altering the environment in such a way that the root causes or facilitators of crime are eliminated. Programs under CPTED, routine activities, defensible space, broken windows, fall under the primary prevention category. Secondary prevention engages in identification of and interventions aimed at potential offenders. Situational crime prevention, neighborhood watch, citizen patrol, protection personnel, rational choices are some secondary crime prevention programs. Tertiary crime prevention aims to deter offenders from committing future crimes. Punishment, tougher legislations, legal reforms are some tertiary crime prevention mechanisms. Thank you for visiting EPG Pathshala.